Welcome back to the channel. In this video, I'm going to talk to you about laser safety and all the things that you need to do to avoid suing me for emotional damage because you burned your house down, or accidentally tattooed your toddler, or choked to death because you thought that you made a campfire and it smelled so good you had to huff it for hours. This isn't meant to scare you off. It's just meant to be informative and let you have all the information ahead of time so that maybe you can stop huffing the fumes coming off of that birch plywood. I was also provided the brand new Lasercam by Mintion to use in this video. However, I'm not being paid to say nice things, so everything that's said in this video is honestly my opinion. So as we go through some of the different safety standards that you should be adhering to as requirements for using lasers, I will also highlight aspects of the Lasercam that can help enhance laser safety. The Lasercam is actually pretty versatile in comparison to a standard web camera that's USB based. Not only does it connect to your Wi-Fi very quickly and allow you to remote observe, but you can also plug it in to your laser and allow it to control the laser as long as it's part of their supported laser list, which is continuously growing. You can use it as a light burn camera just so you can use it for more accurate placements. You can just use it to observe remotely, or you can use it to outright control the laser and take over the world. It does allow you to upload G-code. Ladies. Mintion has a deep history of creating cameras for a variety of different purposes, but mostly 3D printing. It's only now that they have decided to come out with a camera for lasers. Oh, did I mention? The Lasercam also has built-in time-lapse features that you can activate directly from the app on your phone. First things first, let's talk about fire hazards. Every laser, regardless of how much wattage it's putting out, is going to be marking materials by essentially burning it at a wavelength that is compatible with the material. That's why diode lasers working as blue light lasers are incapable of touching transparent items like clear acrylic. But you can do that on a CO2 laser because it's a completely different wavelength. So regardless of all that information I just trauma dumped onto you, you're going to be burning material, which means you need topmost to have a fire extinguisher at your disposal right next to the machine, or at least reachable within the room. Don't put it behind the machine that's 35 inches deep, please, for the love of God. Always test your materials before you start really working on a project. Not only so you know your settings, because every laser is different, even if it's the exact same machine and you got two of them, but also so that you know the burn factor and if you are overcutting or undercutting the material. The other thing is you've got to have laserable materials. You can't just chuck a piece of plywood under it and hope that it's going to be fine, because certain plywoods have more glue in them, less glue, or are too dense, or may even contain a certain level of chemicals such as formaldehyde that when the laser cuts through them, it's putting that out into the air. Another great example is vinyl fabric, plastics, anything that is basically made with PVC, otherwise known as polyvinyl chloride. When PVC is burned, it puts off a really harsh chemical that when it coats parts of your laser, it will actually create an acidic layer and start eating away at the expensive equipment that you purchased. Leather? Yep, you got to be worried about leather too. Make sure you get vegan dyed leather. Don't get leathers that don't have that stamp of approval on them, because again, chemicals. Because lasers are such huge fire hazards, you should never leave them unattended. I don't mean that you need to give it a death stare and watch it while it's working the whole time, but you need to be in the room and have accessibility to the machine to emergency stop it if something, God forbid, were to happen while you were in the room. Worst case scenario, all lasers sold in the United States have to come with a stop button. This is an emergency button that you can hit. It's not going to launch rockets. It's just going to immediately full stop the laser head from producing any light and save you and your home from an insurance claim. However, emergencies happen. Sometimes you really gotta go because you had a bad experience with that taco over the lunch break. And whoo boy, did it hit at just the wrong time. But oh dear God, what are you going to do? Because you can't leave your laser unattended. And while you can actually purchase cameras to go with lasers, and they're third party, they plug into software like Lightburn so that you can accurately place things, they don't actually offer the ability to broadcast so that you can watch the work happen from a distance. And this is great for situations like Montezuma's Revenge. One camera that does actually let you do all of those things and control it remotely is the Mintion Lasercam. Right out of the box, the Lasercam will connect to your Wi-Fi network and broadcast whatever it's looking at to your phone or to an internal website that you can easily access from any computer. Or if you don't want to download the app, you can access it from your phone's browser as well. So if you're sitting on the toilet experiencing poo rage that immediately turns into poo panic, you can open up your phone and immediately stop the laser from functioning. Or you can just sit there and watch it work while you're pooping and then go right back into the room in a hurry, because even though you have a camera on it, you should still never leave the machine unattended. So you're going to be burning materials with your laser, which leads us into the next section of this requirements video for Laser Safety 101, is really good ventilation. You can actually see here that these machines will put off a lot of smoke and fumes. I've taken the opportunity to record this machine cutting into birch plywood so you can actually visualize how much smoke is coming off of it. The only reason it's actually waving off to the right-hand side is because I was smart enough to put a fan on it and open the garage door. Opening the garage door is just one way of dealing with it, but you can't just open the door. You also need to have a fan going to push out the air. And I would say that absolutely, this is like the beginner's bare minimum option. If you're doing this, like, you still need to get some kind of ventilation system onto your laser, which rolls right into the next point of getting some kind of enclosure. Most diode and fiber lasers that you're going to find on the market at a certain price point are not going to come with an enclosure. An enclosure is basically just a fireproof box that you can put the laser in that has a hole in the back for you to add an air filtration system. CO2 lasers, on the other hand, like my Thunder Nova 35 and my GWIC Cloud, basically come with their own systems to draw air out and push them out through the 6-inch air ducting tubes provided. Now, because of that aspect of my GWIC Cloud, I basically just chuck it out the garage door with the garage door only barely lifted, and then I just yeet it off to the right to attack my neighbors. Or you can be an adult and terribly responsible and get somebody to come out and punch a hole into your wall so that you can actually pipe that ducting out through the exterior the appropriate way so that wind doesn't blow it back into your garage and you die of poison. If you're not in a garage, you can actually go to any kind of hardware store and get something to sit in your windowsill to let the fumes go out that way. They have the hole for the ducting and it will just go out that way. Just make sure that when you do that, you insulate it really well so it doesn't come back in. The last Hail Mary you can do for ventilation is just to get an air filtration box. These do exist. They will basically take in the fumes from that ducting unit and try to purify them as best as they can. I cannot speak to the quality of these, nor can I recommend any of them, because I personally have not done that. We just went the full hog, punching a hole through the wall in my garage to get the best results. Moving right along to where to put the darn laser. As you know, these things are pretty large. Even a diode unit is probably gonna have an engravable area of 400 by 400 millimeters. It's pretty big, but your standard 24-inch deep work table is probably going to be just fine. I use Huskies, as you've seen in many of my videos, and I do really like those. Hashtag not sponsored. Of course, the whole point being you need a stable surface. You can't have it on a rickety table. You can't have it on a table that can't be load-bearing, especially when it comes to those desktop CO2 lasers. You're not putting it on this, okay? It's going to fall. They are heavy. They are 150 pounds plus. And they will kill your table and then kill you. Not all lasers come with tilt protection like the Creality Falcon 2 that I've been using throughout this video for some of the demonstrations. So you really do need to have that stable surface. It's really important because if it doesn't detect that it's fallen or tilted or become out of alignment, it's gonna start pew-pewing everything in its way. It'll basically go from being a useful tool to a stormtrooper that has fallen face forward into an imperial cache of crack cocaine. Hello! Now we talk about eye protection, eh? As I mentioned before, these lasers, they're pointing out a lot of different kinds of light at varying wavelengths so that they can cut material. These pulses of light coming from the laser head are radioactive, they are dangerous. Do not stare at the laser. It's almost as fun as staring at the sun for just too long, so let's not do that, okay? Pretty much every laser that I've gotten so far has come with its own version of safety glasses that are supposed to match the wavelength of the laser head. It's important that if you are going to be observing the laser while it's working, that you wear safety goggles that are meant for your laser. Now, these are clunky, they're not very fun to wear, and even though I was told the whole cereal box trick for watching the solar eclipse as a kid, I'm still scared to look. So instead, I prefer to use cameras. And that's another reason why I like the Lasercam. If I have a larger workshop, or even if I need to move outside and I need to do some spray painting just off to the side of my garage, then I can watch it, I can take the laptop with me, or I can take my phone with me and I can keep an eye on things from a distance. I can also set up the camera so it's on a tripod and has a completely different angle than the top-down angle that you see in a lot of the videos that I've been showing so far of me using the camera with the diode laser. This means I can actually watch the pew-pew action without having my eyesight go away magically. Just poof. I also want to add that enclosures also have observation windows that typically match the laser's wavelength so that you are protected and you can kind of peep in on it if you want to do that. However, make sure whatever enclosure you purchase is meant for your laser. The final thing that I will tell you is that you should never touch the laser while it's operating. I mean this when it is framing out the work that you want to do, and especially when the laser is firing, unless you like really crispy looking tattoos. And honestly, regardless of everything, this is why I prefer to have some kind of camera on all of my lasers so that I can control them from light burn and be able to place things and observe what's going on while it's framing and while it's actually doing the work. And I can also accurately place things if I calibrate them correctly in light burn. I don't normally use them for placement, but you can actually attach cameras to your computer. Use Lightburn to calibrate to your laser, just like the Lasercam here has done, and to be able to operate them and place things more accurately. Now, getting them configured and calibrated in Lightburn can be an exercise in humility and a deep test of your patience, but once you get it configured, it's actually pretty darn cool. So that's it for the safety tips, but I don't want to call them tips. Again, we're going to say requirements, because if you don't follow them, you're going to get seriously injured, and I'm not taking responsibility for your Darwinism. But before I close out the video, I want to give some of my high-level thoughts on the Lasercam that Mintion had provided me. Again, I remind you, not being paid to do this, so these are my honest to goodness opinions on the Lasercam. The Lasercam is extremely lightweight. The reason for this isn't lack of build quality, but because it needs to basically be able to dangle over your laser. Meaning the heavier it is, the less likely it is to remain stable, and it'll wobble a lot in the room as the laser moves around on the unit itself. I will say the setup was very easy. I followed the manual that came with the Lasercam, and I was able to have it up and running very, very quickly, accessing both from the app and also from my computer through the webpage that it self-hosts inside the camera, which is pretty freaking cool. Getting it set up with my laser to actually control it was also very easy. It was simply a matter of taking a USB-C to USB-C cable and plugging it into the data port on one side of the Lasercam and then the other end of that cable to my Creality Falcon 2. The only thing fussy about the setup isn't actually a fault of the Lasercam. It's just any camera that you try to hook up into Lightburn to get it to calibrate and be used for accurate placement is always going to have some kind of issue getting set up, and it's not really the best use of my time. I don't typically use cameras for placement. I use them just so I can get somewhat into the zone of where I'm supposed to place something, and then I will use the move tools to get things more accurately placed in Lightburn. The Lasercam did come with everything that I needed, including a separate little tripod with extremely sturdy prongs on it. So I didn't really need to worry about using that if I wanted to just have it off to the side for observational purposes only. But I chose to actually position it just above using that provided L-shaped arm. It is a little bit on the rickety side, but I believe that that's largely due to the fact that there isn't a whole lot of space in the back support beam of the Creality Falcon 2 to really have a nice stable grip on it. So in retrospect, I think I should have gone back and placed a couple of squares of plywood on the top and the bottom so it had a better grip. Also, those time-lapse features are pretty darn cool. We use them with our 3D printers here at Casa de Kittens, and now we can use them with the laser to try to capture some of those larger, more in-depth engraving projects. So as far as my opinion goes, I think it's kind of a no-brainer. The Lasercam, in addition to all of the extra safety enhancement it gives you, especially the fire detection part, and the ability to observe remotely on a website that's self-hosted or in the app, and then time-lapse, kind of makes it a no-brainer. If you'd like more information on the Lasercam or want to purchase your own, I've left information in the description of the video below. Moreover, I want to hear from you in the comments on what you have done to help promote safety standards in your household, if you use lasers at all, or if you have additional questions about lasering and what you need to do to help laser-proof your environment.